Let's get English out of the way. You know how to do your papers. So we get those two done. So we end up with a problem that if a student's already taken English 1, then now what am I going to put in that spot for them to be a full-time student? So I prefer you to be a first-time in college student, but if you're not, we'll just do creative scheduling. We'll make it so we can fill that schedule for you. You need to be comfortable with technology. You need to understand how to use a computer, how to attach files, and there's a test that we give them if they want to take any online class. And I think a lot of colleges have that little, you know, computerized test to make sure you know how to use a computer. We do the same
Let me expand on the test. The test that David is referring to is a required assessment that each student that enrolls in an online class needs to take, and measures aptitude towards the modality, technology familiarity, you know, typing skills, you know, speed and such. And the student needs to take that test once. And once that takes place, the person is, you know, allowed to matriculate in any, you know, in as many online courses moving forward.
So basically just a one-time thing, and a lot of people think they don't need to do it because ours are hybrid, but because we have so much of it online, we do require that they do the online readiness to ensure that they're comfortable with it. They really need to be motivated. They need to, and a lot of students I talk to are people who've been to college once before, 10 years ago, and, you know, didn't have a focus, didn't know they were going, but now they want to get in. And I tell these students, you need to get in, get your degree, and get out. That's what I'm doing for you, okay? You're coming in, you're getting a degree, and you're moving off. So they need to be committed for this 18-month. We put together these learning community cohorts that we have one on Friday night, we have one on Saturday, and they enroll for 2 classes in a 7-week period. 4 classes a semester allows them to remain full-time status. Core completion in 1 year. And you don't have to force these people to be cohort. I mean, they're going to do it automatically. When they start realizing I'm spending all this time together with the same student every week, they share email, they share Facebook, they share Blackboard, they share comments, they all have their own cell phone numbers, they're all in contact with each other. They help each other out. I'm not quite sure what this subject means. I actually had one government instructor said, I think your students are cheating. And I said, how's that? He said, they all got the same answer, which is the wrong answer. I said, it's because they all studied together. They live together. You know, these people are together all the time. So it's a very, very formed group. This is the schedule that we've come up with here to kind of give you an idea of what we're doing. English 1301, English 1302, and this is kind of, it just sets out here. And if you look through the fourth semester here, halfway through the fourth semester, this is going to be our electives over here, and this is your core curriculum over here. Now, the only thing some points to bring out to you here. We decided to use geology as our science class. That's one of the best science classes I found for an accelerated program. Again, I wouldn't do A&P. A lot of people don't want to do biology. A lot of people don't want to do physics. So what's a good class that you can take? And if you remember, for your Associate of Science degree, both of your sciences have to be the same. And for your Associate of Arts degree, they can be different. So I got it covered for arts or science with geology. So you get your 8 hours there. Another change that we did was we arranged and we put our kinesiology class during the same semester as our geology, which balanced it out so you end up with 12 credit hours every semester. So the only reason, so I tell students when you're going to sign up, you sign up for geology and kinesiology in the same semester, and then whatever other class goes with it. So this is a schedule that we came up with. Those last 18 hours, the last 6 classes are electives, and if a student comes in and they already have, you know, 18 hours of drama and ballet and whatever else, they can use those for electives. That's not a problem. They're not stuck in my class where you have to take my classes. But these are the classes that have worked out really well in an accelerated format. A lot of people want to go on into business, so we put the economics inside there. We have the sociology. The BCIS is the business computers, so if you need to learn how to use some software programs with business. And so this has worked out pretty well for us. The only difference that we, one of the differences that we made is we added a second math class here, so a student can choose which math class they want. The way that the degree works in Texas was a 13-14 was required for an Associate of Science, and 13-14, which is Elementary Statistics, was required for Associate of Arts. So they've changed that in the last year, but we put both of them there just in case they want to transfer, they can choose one or the other. So even though they're in a learning cohort, all they have to do is walk across the hallway to pick which class they want, and they'll be back together again for the other classes.
And again, you see that slide. Because you moved that slide, David, one additional aspect that I want to highlight with this degree plan is, as you see, you know, everything is on 7-week terms, if you will. And the other part for our program is that you see the first two classes, and when students are matriculated in those two, we also pre-matriculate them on the second two. Okay, so not only they know the sequence, but they are already pre-part in that sequence, which then minimize or avoids in practical terms, them to go and explore other courses that they may not need, because that's the challenge we face here at the community college. Students take courses left and right, and they don't know what counts towards what, and they end with a number of classes that they don't need. So this strategy keeps them in line, and of course, if you follow this prescription of the degree plan, you will finish in 18 months or less.
So basically, these students, when they first come in to register with me, they sign up for all four classes, as Dr. Mallett said, all four classes. They know what they're taking next semester. I can tell you what your classes are a year from now. I know exactly what classes you're going to be enrolled in. Now, one thing I tell when I'm selling this program, two things really stink when you're a student. Number one is that I need this class really, really bad, and there's no seats available. Number two is I finally found the class that I want. I've enrolled in it, I've rearranged my whole life, and class gets canceled because of low enrollment. Okay? Both of those things never happen in weekend college. Because what we do is I take all of my students that are in the weekend college and say, okay, it's time to register for next semester, go in there and register right now. I give them the list of classes that are available. I give them the list of numbers and how to register. You have 1 month to go register yourself for these classes. They're not visible to the public. They're not visible on WebAdvisor. You can't find them anywhere. It's secret code that only my students have. And then so after they get in there and they register themselves and they got all their seats guaranteed, they're in place, then I open up for anybody else who happens to want a seat. Somebody who needs, I just need one government class. I just need one history class. I just need one. So they're not necessarily part of the weekend college so much, but they're butts in the seat, okay? And when they fill up a seat there, a lot of these students going, wow, I like this. They stay with the cohort. They take two classes the next semester. They like the being able to pre-register in advance and having their seats guaranteed. So we end up getting a lot of students from this growing just by the way that we do this registration.
Yep.
So to be successful, there are three things you need. You need to have the proper faculty, you need to have the proper students, and you have to have dedicated administration. So the proper faculty. We have had teachers who come in who were purely online instructors, and they didn't know how to meet face-to-face. They didn't know how to talk to the students face-to-face. They had no soft skills. They had no people skills. They were really good with the computer, but they didn't know what to talk to the student. We've also had other people who have a lot of experience with face-to-face classes and are not quite sure what to do with this accelerated format in this, how do I mix it with, you know, hybrid. And so we end up looking for somebody who's got experience in both areas, so they know how to mix this up good. What we look for is if you have any experience teaching during summer school, that's really good, because summer school classes are usually, ours are six. Yeah. So as long as you're in that time frame, you know how to do an accelerated class. The only difference is it's supposed to be 4 or 5 days a week. You're only needing one. Okay, so the rest of it goes online. So they need classroom experience, they need the online experience, need the proper students, and I mentioned this at the very beginning. that these students cannot be just anybody who wants to come in out of the school. We don't recruit high school students. Although we could, and I know that we do have some high school graduates come in, but that's not our market. I mean, most of the high school students who come in are not looking to get their degree in 18 months. They're looking to suck up financial aid and to look at homework and maybe mom and dad. And, you know, am I talking from experience? Maybe. Okay. But these are not usually our weekend college students. Usually we have the older adults that come in, older, like they're like 25 or 30. Oh my gosh, they're like old, you know, old people. Students should be computer pros. Now this is something that's really funny because I talk about that. My daughter just turned 31. Yeah, 31. Yeah, I was 10.
Baby, you dated yourself.
I was 10 years old. And I remember that she had a computer when she was a girl. She was a baby in the house. She had a little computer that we played with in the house. The little train that went by and dropped the letters on it. Okay. So, but she's always had a computer. So when we're talking about, does a student need to be computer savvy? Yeah, they need to know something about the computers. Dedicated administration. This is something that we found out was a major problem with weekend college and a lot of other campuses. No one knew who to turn to, no one knew who to talk to, no one knew when they began, no one knew when they ended. It was just like, I'm gonna sign up for some classes. Hey, good luck with for that, you know? And if you need some help in the middle of the night, or if you need some help even at 9 o'clock at night, there's no one around to talk to. So you need someone who's a dedicated administration who's gonna be there to be the face of the program. They aggressively advise the student, meet with the students regularly and push them towards graduation. Now this currently is my job. As I said, the student development, I meet with these students every week. I am their advisor, I'm their registrar, I'm their counselor, I am their financial aid person, I'm their veterans benefits person, I'm the secretary, I am, you know, I take care of everything. Now the good news about that is I voted myself as employee of the month since I'm the only one working week in college, you know. And I nominated myself, I won, since I voted, you know, and as my secretary, I printed my own certificate, so it's great, you know. Working on Employee of the Year. What? So I meet with them every week, and I talk to them about graduation, I talk to them about, okay, what classes do we need? Let's run a degree plan. Okay, look, you know, just change this one here, and move this over here, and I get them, and they're all moving forward towards graduation. And that's the big thing, is they know where the end is. They know when the end is coming. They know where they're going to next. Now, we talked about that 90, and again, I'm gonna date myself just a little bit. I got out of the Army, and I had the GI Bill, so I'm gonna go to school. You know, they're paying me to go to school. So I thought, well, that class looks fun, I think I'll take that. And that class looks fun, I think I'll take that. And I was over at the community college, walking down the hallway, and this counselor walks out, who's probably younger than me. She says, Mr. Pearse, I need to talk to you. I'm going, how do you know me? I've never been in the counselor's office. Am I in trouble here? What did I do, you know? And she said, well, you know, I was reviewing your transcripts and I realized you have 99 credit hours. And I said, yeah, so? She said, if you just took history, you could graduate. I'm going, I don't like history. I don't want to do history. You can't make me do history. You can't force me to do history. I don't want to. She said, if you just took history, you'd graduate. I'm going, really? I could do that. So I took the history classes and graduated. But that's that thing that I was just that wandering person just taking whatever I could for fun. 99 credit hours before the counselor found me, you know? And I had no idea how she found me. I mean, you know, must have had that big pop thing popped up on your computer. Okay, so what's the number one method for retention? Test question.
Anybody.
Anybody, come on. Number one method for retention.
Engagement.
So that's what we're looking for. We're looking for engagement. And so we want to get these students involved. We want to be involved in their lives. We want to be involved in their faces. So when are we involved with these students? We're involved during registration period. We're involved during student development every week. They get an email from me every week. Guess what? This week for student development, we're going to do this. Make sure you show up for that. Don't forget to get your parking passes. Don't forget that the library is going to be closed this week. Don't forget to get your student ID card, blah, blah, blah. Class has been moved to this area here. They get an email from me every week at least one. phone calls that come in, and a lot of you have heard of intrusive advising. I am almost stalker stage, okay? I will get these students know me, they're going, oh God, Mr. Pearse is calling again, okay? So they don't have a chance to like get tired. They don't have a chance to bail out because I'm in their face, you know? These are some things about intrusive advising, and you all can read about intrusive advising. There's just some comments that were made about intrusive advising. So where are we now? For fall 2015, this last semester we just finished, we offer 26 sections. For spring, right now we're offering 46 sections. Now this started last fall 2014 with four classes. Okay, and I need to picture that now, okay? Four classes. In 1 year, we went to 26 classes. 1 year and one semester, we went to 46 classes. Through summer 2015, 162 students have joined. Now here's something that I keep track of. At least 788 different students have taken at least one class from the weekend college. So although I can't take credit for them graduating, I'm gonna take credit because they graduated, okay? Because you know, they couldn't graduate if they didn't take my weekend college class, okay? So we got them to be able to graduate. 120 sections have been offered, 1,610 seats have been filled. That's in 1 year, okay? Not knocking your socks off, but that's pretty impressive to me. You know, when we're talking about what we're doing in one campus in 1 year. May 2015, we're gonna have our very first graduates. May 2015, last year, three students graduated that had taken at least one weekend college course. So that lasted through two semesters that took a course with me. December 2015, two students from the weekend college graduated. Remember that we said that in 18 months or less, because if you do our plan, you go through 18 months. But if you want to take an online course or take a side course or you come in with some electives already, we need to do it quicker than that. I've got two students who graduated this past December who were completely 100% weekend college students, but just took some extra classes to be able to graduate. Our very first graduates from our very first class that started in September of 2014, right, will now graduate this coming up May, our very first cohort. The general comments I get from this is, I can't believe it's over already. It just went so fast. When you're thinking about a year and a semester, you know, these people are surprised how quickly it's gone along.
Now, that's
go ahead, sir.
On the previous slide, you can just back on. One additional element, you know, those figures you are seeing here, I mean, those comments, in the case of May 2016, we are going through the graduation clearance, as is described here in Tarrant, for those students that keep completing hours, keep completing their degrees, because what we have witnessed is that many students have used two things. You know, we had students taking weekend classes only through the cohort, but we also had students that took advantage of the weekend college, and that's what they described before. Students that took advantage because they were needing one or two classes, and they accelerated. You know, it's 7 weeks, and you get done with that. So you are always kind of in a summer session every time. So, you know, next time we see each other, we will report on how many students graduated in the May 2016 graduation ceremony.
Right. So here's some numbers here for you. Just kind of take a look. At the very first, when we first started off with the first 8 week sessions here, two faculty. That's what we had. We had English and History, that was it. And the number of students that we had, how many sections we offered, unduplicated enrollment, total seat count, total enrollment for each one. And this is how many students are taking just at least one class through weekend college. Let me move this over here so you can see that. So you can see our totals there. 120 sections, total enrollment seat count 1,610. Through the fall, we have 788 students that have been enrolled in this. So you can see that it's been very, very effective to be able to get the students in, get them their information they need, and getting them out. So here's some comments that we had from some students. When we went through SACS accreditation, our